W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of Surviving Katyn, Stalin's Polish Massacre and the Search for Truth by Jane Rogoyska, narrated by Jane Rogoyska. Note: many people understandably assume that the term Katyn or Katyn Massacre refers to a single event. In fact, it is an umbrella term used to designate the murder of nearly 22,000 Polish prisoners of war, mainly but not uniquely officers of the Polish army, who were killed by the NKVD in different locations around the Soviet Union between April and May 1940 as a consequence of a direct order signed off by Stalin on the 5th of March 1940. In April 1943, the German army discovered the bodies of just over 4,000 of these prisoners in the Katyn Forest near Smolensk in Russia, giving rise to the name. Note on place names. Many of the place names featured in this book have changed several times over the course of recent history. For places featuring frequently in the text, I have used the names used by the Poles during the period in which events occurred. Thus, present-day Lviv is Lvov, Vilnius is Vilno. Others I have updated. Preface. Imagine, if you will, several thousand men who have recently experienced a crushing defeat in battle. Of these, approximately half are professional soldiers. The others are reservists, officers who, until only weeks ago, were busily engaged in civilian professions as lawyers, engineers, teachers, politicians, journalists, scientists, writers, doctors, priests. All are men accustomed to be in control of their lives. Now, bemused and bewildered, woefully, tragically out of their depth, they face a new and inscrutable enemy. Not soldiers with guns, but officers of the NKVD, highly trained professionals whose methods of operation are mystifying, whose special skill is the control of a population through terror. The barest of facts about the 1940 Katyn massacre are easily summarised. On the 17th of September 1939, just 2 weeks after Britain and France declared war on Nazi Germany following its invasion of Poland from the west, the Red Army invaded from the east. No declaration of war was made. Thousands of members of the Polish armed forces were captured as they retreated from the German onslaught, then taken to prison camps across the Soviet Union. After several weeks, the enlisted men and NCOs were sent home, leaving behind some 14,800 officers, police, and border guards imprisoned in three special NKVD-run prisoner of war camps at Kozelsk near Smolensk in Russia, Starobielsk near Kharkiv in Ukraine, and Ostashkov near Kalinin, now Tver, in Russia. For 7 months, the men were questioned by NKVD interrogators, their loyalties probed, their susceptibility to communist conversion tested. In April to May 1940, all but 395 of these men were murdered in the strictest secrecy on the direct orders of the head of the NKVD, Lavrenti Beria, signed off by Stalin. It was not until April 1943, when the USSR and Germany were no longer allies and the German army had advanced into Soviet territory, that the Nazis discovered mass graves in the Katyn Forest near Smolensk. The bodies were those of 4,000 Polish officers previously held in Kozelsk camp. This shocking revelation led to one of the most bitterly fought propaganda battles of World War II. While the Nazis sought to divide the Allies with evidence of Bolshevik bestiality, the Soviets pointed the finger at Hitler's fascist hangman, claiming the massacre had taken place not in 1940, but 1941, when the Smolensk area was under Nazi control. Given the Allied position of dependence on Stalin to win the war against Hitler, neither Britain nor the US dared challenge the Soviet version of events. So the story was allowed to stand. The Katyn massacre officially became a Nazi crime, complete with fake dates and fake monuments. the fate and whereabouts of the missing prisoners of Starobielsk and Ostashkov camps remained a mystery until the collapse of communism in 1990, when Soviet President Mikhail Gorbachev finally acknowledged Katyn as a Stalinist crime and handed over relevant NKVD documents to the Polish President, General Wojciech Jaruzelski. The bodies of the prisoners of Starobielsk camp were revealed to be buried in Piatykatki Park near Kharkov, those of the prisoners of Ostashkov in Mednoye near Tver. Researchers have subsequently increased the total number of victims to nearly 22,000, 21,857 to be precise, including 7,300 Polish officers who were held in prisons in Ukraine and Belarusia and murdered under the same order. Knowledge of the Katyn massacre in the West is fading fast. Many people have never heard of it. Those who have are often familiar only with the basic outlines of the story. In Poland, by contrast, Katyn remains deeply controversial, a source of national pain and a continuing bone of contention between Russia and Poland, in which politics plays a prominent role. Nazi crimes have been examined and laid bare in all their brutal detail. Apologies and reparations made and paid. By contrast, the decades of enforced silence on the subject of Soviet misdeeds have left this period of history live and incomplete. There are still gaps to be filled in, scores to be settled. The legacy of resentment and mistrust continues to play out across Eastern Europe. So why should we care about Katyn now? As the British Permanent Undersecretary for Foreign Affairs, Alexander Cadogan, pointed out in 1943, the death of a few thousand Poles at the hands of the NKVD is a drop in the ocean compared to the millions of Soviet citizens murdered by Stalin. Indeed, the number of Polish citizens who died as a result of the Soviet deportations of 1940-41 was infinitely greater, in the hundreds rather than the tens of thousands. Among the many crimes of the Stalinist era, one might question why Katyn has come to hold such symbolic importance. The methods employed by the Stalinist state to dispose of its enemies were many and various: show trials, executions, labour camps, take your pick, the list is long. But even by those brutal standards, the organised murder of thousands of foreign nationals held not as criminals, but as prisoners of war was unusual. The NKVD might dispatch foreign individuals to the gulag, they might assassinate them, but they did not generally deliberately eliminate them en masse. That was a fate reserved for Soviet citizens. The men in question belonged to Poland's elite. Their loss wiped out a generation of thinkers, politicians, soldiers, artists. The massacre formed part of a wider Stalinist strategy aimed at removing anyone who might conceivably pose a threat to the imposition of future Soviet rule in Poland. A decapitation of Polish society strikingly similar to Nazi policy in occupied Poland at the same time. The symbolism of their deaths is powerful enough, memorable and disturbing. But what really makes Katyn stand out from other, equally murderous crimes, and what makes it so relevant today, is what we might call the lie. For over four decades, the Soviet state maintained the fiction of Katyn as a Nazi crime, an achievement made possible by the unparalleled dedication of the Soviet and Communist Polish security services in controlling the story. The deceit began in 1940, with rumours deliberately cultivated to make the prisoners believe they were going home. The effect was so complete that for a long time, the men who survived were convinced they were the ones who had been left behind. It continued with a series of often dramatic interventions designed to silence and intimidate those who would speak out, as the NKVD, later the KGB, the UB and SB, worked tirelessly to reshape the facts into their desired form, from planting documents on dead bodies to pursuing a truck full of evidence across Europe, destroying records or staging accidents in European capitals. The people who paid the highest price for this elaborately constructed edifice of deceit were those who could, or would, call into question the official version of events. Only 395 men survived the Katyn massacre. For many of them, their role as unwitting witnesses to a crime that officially never happened brought them exile, persecution, arrest. Most powerfully, it brought them a twin mystery that would haunt them for the remainder of their lives. Why were our comrades killed and not us? And its mirror image, why were we saved and not them? Introduction. Capture. The news of this stab in the back was like the sensation one feels in the theatre when a crime which has long been impending is finally perpetrated. Nazi Germany's invasion of Poland on the 1st of September 1939 is one of the 20th century's most familiar dates, followed 2 days later by a declaration of war by Britain and France. The next few months of military inactivity, dubbed variously the Phony War, Twilight War, Drôle de Guerre, Funny War, or Sitzkrieg, Sitting War, fills barely a page in most Western history books. Britain slowly mobilised while France and Germany glared at each other from behind the seemingly impregnable safety of the Maginot and Siegfried lines. For the Polish protagonists of this book, by contrast, the 8 months between September and April 1940 mark the tragic opening act in a drama which has not yet fully played itself out today. For them, the significant date comes barely 2 weeks after the war's official start. Whereas Hitler's actions surprised no one, the arrival of 500,000 Red Army soldiers at Poland's eastern borders on the 17th of September 1939 was so unexpected that Polish forces, caught up in a chaotic retreat from the German onslaught, did not at first know whether to greet them as enemies or friends. The Soviet action was a direct consequence of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, signed in Moscow on the 23rd of August 1939 by Soviet Commissar for Foreign Affairs Vyacheslav Molotov and German Foreign Minister Joachim von Ribbentrop. This unlikely last-minute alliance had emerged on the tail of a series of slow-moving and unconvincing efforts by Great Britain and France over the early summer of 1939 to cooperate with the Soviet Union in facing down German aggression. The talks had left Soviet leader Joseph Stalin frustrated, insulted, and, finally, open to the idea of collaboration with Hitler. The benefit of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact to Hitler was obvious. It gave him carte blanche to invade Poland, safe in the knowledge that her great eastern neighbour would not intervene. The advantage to Stalin was concealed in a secret supplementary protocol which envisaged the future disposition of territories of interest to both sides, setting out Soviet and German spheres of influence in the Baltic states and Romania, and drawing a line down Poland, dividing it in half. It also included a trade deal highly beneficial to both parties. Neither Germany nor the Soviet Union had been reconciled to the territorial losses resulting from the rebirth of Poland at the end of World War I. Since 1772, when Russia, Austria, and Prussia first subjugated the once great Commonwealth of Poland-Lithuania, the country had been partitioned 3 times between these 3 great powers, finally ceasing to exist as an independent state in the third partition of 1795. For Hitler, Poland was the unreal creation of the 1919 Treaty of Versailles. For Molotov, it was its ugly offspring. The pact presented an opportunity to reacquire these territories while avoiding conflict with one another. The weather is superb, the sun is shining, the summer is dry. The river levels are low. The German tanks encounter no obstacles. A splendid visibility favours the enemy planes. Ours, unfortunately, no longer exist. The blitzkrieg unleashed by the Nazis on Poland represented a new and devastating form of warfare for which no army could have been fully prepared. Tanks rolled over harvest-ready fields, aircraft rained bombs and bullets on military and civilian targets alike. The popular image of the Polish army as a band of valiant but doomed knights fighting a modern war with last century's weapons is far from reality, but their 900,000 men could not hope to match the 1.5 million strong Wehrmacht. Faced with an enemy numerically superior and infinitely better equipped, Polish forces retreated east in the hope that help would arrive from their Western allies, allowing them time to regroup and launch a counterattack. Polish faith in Allied action was admirable but misplaced. At this stage, neither the French nor the British were able or prepared to offer Poland anything except warm words. Left to fight alone, the Polish army was soon overwhelmed. As the Germans advanced on Warsaw, the Polish government and high command fled east to the town of Brest-Litovsk, now Brest in Belarus. Then, on the 17th of September 1939, in defiance of all former Soviet-Polish non-aggression pacts, the Red Army crossed Poland's eastern border. In Poland, they called it the stab in the back. In the early hours of the morning of the 17th of September, the Soviet Deputy Commissar for Foreign Affairs, Vladimir Potemkin, summoned Poland's ambassador, Wacław Grzybowski, to his office in Moscow and attempted to hand him a note from the Soviet government. One glance at the text convinced Grzybowski to refuse to accept it. "The Polish government has collapsed and shows no signs of life. This means that the Polish state and its government have, in fact, ceased to exist. Therefore, the agreements concluded between the USSR and Poland have ceased to operate. Left to its own devices and bereft of leadership, Poland has become a fertile field for all kinds of accidents and surprises which could pose a threat to the USSR. Therefore, the Soviet government, which has been neutral until now, can no longer maintain a neutral attitude towards these facts. Nor can the Soviet government remain indifferent to the fact that its kindred Ukrainian and Belarusian peoples, living on Polish territory, are abandoned to their fate and left unprotected. In view of this state of affairs, the Soviet government has directed the High Command of the Red Army to order troops to cross the frontier and to take under their protection the lives and property of the population of Western Ukraine and Western Belarusia. At the same time, the Soviet government intends to take all measures to liberate the Polish people from the disastrous war into which they have been dragged by their unwise leaders and to give them the opportunity to live a peaceful life." In refusing the note, Grzybowski pointed out that the Polish army fought on and its government was still in existence. Potemkin eventually prevailed upon him to communicate its contents to the Polish government. Molotov, meanwhile, copied it to all ambassadors in Moscow, reassuring them of Soviet neutrality. A public broadcast repeated the information. Ambassador Grzybowski could also legitimately have asked Potemkin, "From whom or what is the valiant Soviet army protecting the Ukrainians and Belarusians living in Poland's eastern territories? What are the accidents and surprises that could harm the USSR, since the Germans were allied to the Soviets and therefore posed no threat? Rogue Poles? Bandits?" The ambassador would doubtless also have noticed the ominous reference to Poland's eastern territories as Western Ukraine and Western Belarusia. The region in question, known in Polish as Kresy or Borderlands, did indeed contain substantial Ukrainian and Belarusian minorities, as well as Jews, who were not, it seems, in such urgent need of Soviet protection. The multicultural nature of the population reflected both the broad makeup of pre-war Poland and the historically fluid nature of borders in this region. In the ferment following the 1917 Russian Revolution, both Ukraine and Belarusia had declared, fought for, and lost their independence, their eastern territories eventually going to the Soviet Union, and the remaining western areas to Poland. Poland's re-emergence as an independent nation had presented numerous challenges, not least that of uniting the three separate legal and educational systems, currencies, and even railway gauges produced by over a century of Russian, Austrian, and German rule. The task had been met by successive Polish governments with the same varying levels of inspiration, incompetence, and misjudgment to be found in any European country during the 1920s and 30s. That is to say, their policies, combined with a role of prejudice, snobbery, and nationalism, could provide many good reasons why sections of Poland's minorities might be discontented and might even welcome the Soviet invasion, at least at first. From the outset, Stalin had a precise goal: He wanted permanent control of this region, joining the defenseless Ukrainian and Belarusians with their brethren in the neighbouring Soviet Socialist Republics of Ukraine and Belarusia. Both of these had recently been divested of large portions of their ethnic Polish population during an operation against Polish spies in which the NKVD executed over 110,000 Soviet Poles during the Great Terror of 1937-38. In a second treaty signed on the 28th of September 1939, the Soviet Union and Germany formalised what, in effect, constituted the Fourth Partition of Poland. A further secret supplementary protocol gave Germany control of the regions around Lublin and Warsaw, previously allotted to the Soviet sphere of interest, in exchange for Soviet control in Lithuania. Despite endless political discussions about Poland's eastern borders during the course of the war, Stalin's ruthlessly effective land grab was eventually rubber-stamped by the Allies at the Yalta Conference in February 1945. On the day of the Soviet invasion, the Polish president, Ignacy Moszczycki, and senior members of his government had reached Kuty near the Romanian border. When he first heard the news, Moszczycki was initially unsure how to react, but once Ambassador Grzybowski had communicated the contents of the Soviet diplomatic note, all doubts vanished. The Red Army was advancing rapidly in their direction. A decision had to be made: stay and fall into Soviet hands, or flee. Moszczycki decided on the latter course, reasoning it was preferable to continue the fight from abroad than surrender. The Polish government crossed into Romania the same day, followed shortly afterwards by the Commander-in-Chief, Marshal Edward Rydz-Szmigły, and his staff. Under pressure from Germany, the supposedly neutral Romanian government promptly interned the President, Commander-in-Chief and Prime Minister, along with many other top officials, as a consequence of which, new leaders had to be chosen from those who'd managed to reach France unscathed. Władysław Radziszewicz was made president. General Władysław Sikorski took on the dual role of Prime Minister and Commander-in-Chief. The decision to flee was controversial. Citizens enduring bombardment in Polish cities felt abandoned. Many officers viewed the departure of their commander-in-chief while Polish forces were still fighting as shameful. But the decision allowed Polish units to join Allied forces abroad and enabled a sophisticated network of resistance to operate throughout the war in the form of the Polish underground state and the Home Army, Armia Krajowa, AK, formed in 1940 under the direction of the government in exile after it moved from France to London. If the Soviet invasion came as a complete surprise to the Polish government, it caused utter confusion among forces on the ground. The move east had severely disrupted communications with Army High Command. As a consequence, nobody had the slightest idea whether the Red Army was coming to help or to conquer. The confusion was further amplified by an order issued by Marshal Rydz-Szmigły before he left Poland, instructing Polish troops not to fight the Soviets unless they came under direct attack. The order eventually filtered through just at the moment when the threat from the Red Army was becoming all too evident. Although some Polish units resisted, many others surrendered in response to Rydz-Szmigły's command. On the morning of the 17th of September, 40-year-old Reserve Second Lieutenant Bronisław Młynarski had reached the town of Dubno, some 35 miles from the Soviet border. After reporting to garrison command, he was awaiting orders, along with hundreds of other officers converging on the town from all over Poland. Urbane, humorous, warm-hearted, Młynarski was by profession a businessman, deputy director of the government-owned Gdynia America shipping line. But his passion was music. It ran in his family. His father was the eminent composer and conductor Emil Młynarski. His sister Aniela was married to the celebrated pianist Artur Rubinstein. Both Młynarski's sisters lived in the US, where he had spent many years. Like his good friend, the artist Józef Czapski, Bronisław Młynarski belonged to a generation of cultured, cosmopolitan Poles who had come of age in newly independent Poland and seen it flourish. A talented raconteur, he spoke English, French, German, and Russian, and could hold an audience in all four languages. Since receiving his call-up papers in the last-minute general mobilization, Młynarski had seen no action, spending the first 2 weeks of the war travelling ever further eastwards in a largely futile attempt to locate and join his unit. On his circuitous journey from Warsaw, he had fallen in with a couple of fellow officers, both reserve lieutenants like him, a towering 35-year-old forester, Zygmunt Kwarczynski, and an engineer, Józef Laudanski, known as Laud, whose round and friendly face reminded Młynarski of a country vicar. The three were to form the core of a group of friends who would remain inseparable over the next 8 months. Although the war was barely a fortnight old, there was already an element of routine in the daily German bomber attacks. With meticulous regularity, they passed overhead every morning at 6 a.m., flying from west to east. On the morning of the 17th of September, a change occurred. Nearly 1 hour after the morning raid, a formation of 30 planes approached from the east, flying west. They dropped no bombs. After firing a few salvos, the Polish AKAT guns fell silent. Zygmunt, Laud, and I were standing not far from one of our guns. Puzzled by the unusual display, we rushed to our anti-aircraft experts who knew the silhouettes of every aircraft by heart. As we were approaching them, we saw that they were greatly agitated. With his usual coolness and characteristic drawl, Laud said, "It looks to me as if they're not German planes." "My guess is that they're French or maybe British," said Zygmunt, "and they've come from Romania. Things will be fine now, my friends, just you see." The experts were not convinced. They looked anxious. "What sort of planes were they, for heaven's sake? British or French?" they asked. More of our companions had now joined us around the battery. A general uproar resulted. Finally, put in a spot, the commanding officer, a young lieutenant, announced calmly and distinctly, "Gentlemen, they were neither British nor French. They were Soviet planes." As each man put forward his interpretation of the strange event, the group grew more excited, speculating in ever more fanciful terms as to the meaning of the strange apparition. After several hours, news of the invasion began to filter in from the Polish-Soviet border. The men argued violently about how to interpret the Soviet presence on Polish soil, with the blind optimists on one side and the pessimists on the other, who had fallen prey to complete despair. The fight was short-lived. As more dismal news came in, the camp of enthusiasts was dwindling fast. This scene was repeating itself all over eastern Poland. With the Germans advancing rapidly from the west and the Soviets closing in from the east, it was now abundantly clear there was only one option left. A corridor remained, narrowing by the day, which neither the Germans nor the Soviets had yet reached. Down this, the remains of the army hastened, hoping to get out of Poland into Hungary or Romania, and from there make their way to France. Around 35,000 members of the Polish armed forces succeeded in escaping in this manner. The rest were not so lucky. Towards evening on the 19th of September, Bronisław Młynarski and his friends were part of a vast column of men and vehicles slowly heading south. Towards dusk, they reached a tiny hamlet named Dolna Kaluska. Here, Młynarski recalled a scene of bucolic peace, with swampy fields to one side, farmyards and peasant cottages on the other. In front of them, a large wooden bridge spanned the river. Several cars and trucks had already crossed the bridge, accelerating to climb the steep hill on the other side before swerving sharply round a tight corner and disappearing, one after the other, in clouds of dust behind a curtain of thick green foliage. It was then that a violent burst of bullets spluttered from the opposite bank. After a short battle with an invisible enemy, silence fell, interrupted by an ominous rumbling sound that suggested the presence of tanks. Then came shouting from the other side of the river. As he waited, crouched in a ditch, staring at the bodies strewn on the road, Młynarski was overcome by a feeling of dread. Some dark, monstrous spectre seemed to advance gradually and rhythmically, crushing one by its sheer mass and weight. a voice called out in Russian. Stop firing. You are surrounded. Give yourselves up, or else we'll finish everybody off. For a brief moment, Winarski contemplated the idea of using his brand new gun, never used except to test it, to shoot himself. He had been a student in Moscow during the Russian Revolution and witnessed the bloody violence that followed. He was under no illusion about what would await him in Soviet captivity. And so there I was, toying with my gun, pressing it against my temple. Or would it not be better in my mouth? No, with my mouth wide open, it looked so stupid. Damn it. No, dash it all, this would be too easy. At that moment, I felt suddenly as if somebody had wanted to snatch my cap from my head. Zygmunt yelled behind my back, "For God's sake, hide your head or you'll lose it!" A bullet had grazed Monarski's head. Zygmunt passed him a handkerchief to staunch the blood, and the momentary desire to put an end to his life passed. He sat in the ditch with his friends and watched as a young Air Force lieutenant crossed the bridge carrying a stick with a white scarf fastened to it. After a while, the young man returned alone. Then he and a lieutenant colonel walked slowly back again, step in step, into the lion's den to discuss the capitulation of the Polish army. Artist and writer Józef Czapski was captured some days later, on the 27th of September, at Chmielek, not far from the city of Lviv, now Lviv, in Ukraine. After days of wandering with two reserve cavalry squadrons, without horses and almost without arms, they meandered east, then west, before finally being encircled by Soviet tanks and artillery. For 10 days, Polish commander General Władysław Langner had managed to defend Lviv against the Germans, but the arrival of the Red Army on the 19th of September brought the siege to an abrupt end. The German army withdrew, leaving Langner and General Franciszek Sikorski to negotiate the terms of surrender with the Soviets, signed on the 22nd of September. The Soviets gave Langner concrete assurances that privates and NCOs would be allowed to go home, officers would be free to leave Poland and cross into Romania and Hungary to reach France. The promise was broken as soon as the Red Army occupied the city. The officers were arrested and taken to Tarnopol, after which the majority, including General Franciszek Sikorski, were transferred to Starobiaz camp. The Red Army soldiers charged with taking prisoners were mainly young conscripts known as boytsy, drawn from every corner of the Soviet Union. After rounding up their captives, they disarmed them, roughly separating the officers from the enlisted men before relieving them of their valuables. Wedding and signet rings were torn from fingers, watches, leather belts, map holders, bags. Some even snatched the eagles from the officers' caps and ripped off their epaulettes, all the while insulting them in class terms as pani, lords or masters, or pomieszczyki, landowners. They showed a strange terror, which was further expressed by their senseless shouting and the way in which they searched us, brutally prodding our bodies as though our uniforms concealed bombs. For 22 years, the authorities had been cramming into their heads the idea that anybody living outside their country was automatically an enemy of the people, of the Soviets, a bandit and a kravapitsa, that is, a man who feeds on the blood of the exploited masses of working-class people or peasants. Meanwhile, the Soviets dropped leaflets on Polish troops. Soldiers, turn on your officers and generals. Do not submit to the orders of your officers. Drive them out from your soil. Come to us boldly, to your brothers, to the Red Army. Here you will be cared for. Here you will be respected. Many Polish officers and NCOs, police, civilians and border guards were shot on the spot. But the majority were taken prisoner, along with vast numbers of enlisted men. For days they rode on trucks or marched on foot, weak from hunger and exhaustion, along main roads, lined with the statues of saints, their crosses broken and knocked over by Soviet troops, until they reached the border. Here, a vast strip of no man's land, enforced by barbed wire, served as a physical reminder of the isolation in which the Soviet state kept its people from the outside world. Once over the border, prisoners were greeted by their first sight of a Soviet town. Józef Czapski recalled it vividly. Another world. Poor, ugly houses which looked as if they had never been repaired. the famous electrification about which so much had been written in luxury print editions, the odd electric bulb blinking with a feeble reddish light, Stalin's profile in red neon in the middle of a miserable little square. That was all. Between late September and early October 1939, thousands of Polish prisoners of war were brought to wait by railway lines to be transported to destinations unknown. At some point during this part of the journey, prisoners noticed that the frightened young Boitsy had been replaced by men wearing different uniforms with distinctive red-banded caps. These new arrivals moved calmly among the crowds, answering the endless questions put to them by anxious officers. Would their belongings be returned to them? Would they be given toothbrushes, razors, or soap? Would they be able to write to their families? And what about receiving their pay? The questions reflected the expectations of Polish officers captured as prisoners of war, according to internationally recognized norms formalized in the 1929 Geneva Convention. To every question, the red-capped officers replied with brief, soothing answers.
Da, da, u nas co jest, u nas wcio mnogo.
Yes, there's plenty of everything in our country.
Da, koniecznie, eta budżet,
etc. Of course it will be like that. We shall return all your things, and there will be soap, too. Tomorrow, the day after tomorrow. Nothing to worry about. We shall make you feel safe. These men were politruks, political commissars of the NKVD, the Narodny Komisariat Wnutrennych Del, the People's Commissariat of Internal Affairs. This was Stalin's internal security service, the precursor to the KGB and the Soviet Union's most efficient organization. It was run by the pince-nez-wearing industrialist of terror, Lavrenty Beria, who had recently taken over the reins from his predecessor and former boss, Nikolai Yezhov. Having presided over Stalin's great terror, Yezhov was now in disgrace and would shortly be executed. When the trains eventually arrived, the prisoners were loaded inside, 80 to a wagon, up to 1,000 in each transport. There were no seats. Crushed up against one another in the darkness, back to back, legs uncomfortably intertwined, they had no idea how long their journey would last, nor where they were being taken. All they knew was that the direction of travel was east, into the heart of the Soviet Union. Warsaw held out against the Germans until the 27th of September 1939. The last Polish fighting unit disbanded on the 6th of October. Poland was now a wholly occupied country. The Nazis controlled Western and Central Poland. The Soviets occupied the East. Part 1. Starobielsk, Kozielsk, Ostaszków, 1939-40. Chapter 1. Monasteries. In the distance, on the left side of the road, a high, long wall glistened white. Silhouetted against the sky behind the wall were the rooftops of a number of buildings dominated by the bulbous outline of a dark blue church cupola. As we approached the wall, we saw that it was reinforced on the outside by a high barbed wire abatis and dotted with many wooden mushroom-shaped towers inside which we saw machine guns and huge searchlights. Since the 17th of September, the Red Army had captured between 230,000 and 240,000 members of the Polish military, including around 10,000 officers. The army had no expertise in dealing with large numbers of prisoners or in running prison camps, so the task was entrusted to the only Soviet organization capable of operating on such a vast scale, the NKVD. Within 2 days of the invasion, preparations were in place. On the 18th of September, NKVD convoy troops were put on a war footing and instructed to take charge of the reception points to which the Polish prisoners of war were being taken. On the 19th of September, the head of the NKVD, Lavrenty Beria, ordered the establishment of the Administration for Prisoner of War Affairs, or UPV, Uprawlenie po delam wojennoplennych, to be run by NKVD Major Piotr Soprunienko under the supervision of Beria's deputy and close colleague, Zefolod Merkulov. Regimental Commissar Semyon Nekoroshev was to act as the UPV's commissar. A A total of 14 prison camps were made ready to receive Polish prisoners of war. Of these, 7 were transit camps, 4 were labour camps, and 3, Kozielsk, Starobielsk and Ostaszków, were designated as special camps where officers, prominent state and military officials, intelligence agents, counterintelligence agents, gendarmes, prison guards and police would be held. Each camp was situated in a different region of the Soviet Union. Kozielsk lay 200 miles southeast of Smolensk in Russia, Starobielsk in the eastern part of Soviet Ukraine, about 150 miles from Kharkov, Ostaszków lay 150 miles west of the city of Kalinin, now Tver, in Russia's freezing north. High-ranking and staff officers were to be sent to Starobielsk, police and prison guards to Ostaszków. Privates from the German part of Poland were to be divided between Kozielsk and Putivl camp in Ukraine. When it became obvious that Starobielsk could not hold all the officers, several thousand were sent on to Kozielsk, which thus became an officer camp. Given the sheer number of Polish prisoners captured by the Red Army, the Politburo swiftly decided that privates and non-commissioned officers would be released and sent home. In civilian life, these mainly young men were labourers, drivers, agricultural or factory workers. They were of no strategic or political interest to the Soviet authorities. Since it was impossible to separate officers from men effectively in the field, the process of sorting took place within the camps themselves. As a result, between early October and mid-November, thousands of men arrived in the 3 special camps only to be sent back home again, in some cases returning on the train in which they'd just arrived. Residents of the Soviet zone of occupation went first, followed by those whose homes were in German-occupied territory, who were handed over to the German authorities in a prisoner exchange. Others were sent to work on roads and in mines within the Soviet Union. The chaos of those first weeks is hard to overestimate. On the 14th of October 1939, Starobielsk camp held over 7,000 men, including 4,813 privates and NCOs, 2,232 officers and 155 others. By the 1st of April 1940, there were 3,893 prisoners, almost all of them officers. In Kozielsk, the camp population halved from a total of nearly 9,000, mainly privates, to 4,599, mainly officers. A total of 16,000 men passed through Ostaszków camp. After 9,400 privates and NCOs were released to the Germans and others transferred to work in the mines, the camp population settled at 6,364. It was not until mid-November that camp numbers finally stabilised and a routine was established. The 3 camps were housed in former monasteries or convents whose occupants had been massacred during the revolution, their buildings then repurposed for use by the NKVD. The sites bore grim witness to the violence of the recent past. In Starobielsk, formerly an Orthodox clerical seminary, tombs in the old graveyard had been uncovered. Prisoners found skulls and bones buried in the shallow earth in the grounds. Bullet marks scarred the walls. Ostaszków camp occupied the remains of the magnificent Nilova Hermitage on Stolobny Island in Lake Seliger. Prisoners making repairs to the monastery cellars came across bones and scraps of fabric, even part of a gun. 2 of the original monks had apparently survived and still worked there. One of them, a tall man with expressionless face and deep sunken eyes who looked like a walking corpse, never spoke. Despite the NKVD's fearsome reputation for efficiency honed in running the vast network of Soviet labour camps known as the Gulag, camp commanders faced a considerable logistical challenge in financing and organising the provision of food, material and medical supplies for so many prisoners of war arriving simultaneously and at such short notice. Transports comprising hundreds of Polish officers and enlisted men streamed daily into camps which, despite hasty preparations, were in no fit state to accommodate them. In Kozielsk, construction of the bunks had only just begun when the first prisoners arrived. There was not enough straw for mattresses and a lack of sheets, blankets and pillows. A chronic shortage of brooms, cloths and bins made cleaning the camp next to impossible, while the toilets, inadequate in number, had no roofs or walls. Food supplies were unevenly distributed, with many essential items missing and an almost total lack of fresh food. As to the matter of vegetables, the situation is bad indeed. We have enough potatoes for 3 or 4 days, and now they're not bringing them to the camp because the region did not complete a supply plan, and all the local potatoes are being sent to Moscow. There is no cabbage at all, and no hope of obtaining any. It was dusk when Bronisław Młynarski passed through the gates of Starobielsk along with a group of around 1,000 men. The only order they received on arrival, shouted by a revolver-wielding politruk from the steps of the church, was to find themselves somewhere to sleep for the night. Młynarski had managed to stick with his cheerful group of friends, and together they went in search of shelter. Every building was already full to bursting, every spare inch of muddy ground occupied by men stretched out on coats or blankets. As darkness fell, bringing with it a penetrating cold, the friends decided to take a look inside the smaller of the two churches. It had already acquired a nickname, the Circus, or sometimes Shanghai. Upwards of 1,000 men lay on cramped bunks piled up to the ceiling on a precarious metal scaffold. On the floor, sleeping men squeezed together like pilchards. The entire space reeked of unwashed bodies and dirt. A young reserve army doctor, Zbigniew Godlewski, arrived in Starobielsk in early October. He found the building so intimidating it was a month before he dared enter it. The ranks and ranks of bunks, the darkness, the noise of people swearing and shouting. As soon as I entered, some cried out, "Shut the door," while others shouted, "There's no harm in a little fresh air." Immediately I was asked whom I'd come to visit. As I did not answer immediately, cries went up. "Look, a stranger's come to spy on us. Something will go missing, that's for sure. Or maybe he's a sneak." I was swiftly surrounded by several people. Fortunately, I remembered the name of my acquaintance, and they recognized me from chopping wood. Yusuf Chapsky described the circus as a strange and intimidating place to be entered as one would a jungle. His close friend, the engineer Zygmunt Mitera, lived there, as did a lively group of students from the Academy of Arts in Warsaw, and an avant-garde poet from Kraków, Lech Piwowar, who had married just a few weeks before the outbreak of war. In the centre of the church was a stage that had apparently been used for party and Komsomol, Communist Youth League, meetings. Several prisoners slept underneath it, entering and exiting via the prompter's box. The larger church building remained locked throughout their stay. Rumour had it that it was used to store grain which was sent to the front to feed German soldiers. On the summit of its cupola was an Orthodox cross. It did not reach upwards in a proud vertical line. Corroded at its base by the rust of time, it hung crooked and inert. In the confusion created by the departure of the enlisted men, some officers saw an opportunity. With registration yet to begin, restless young men weighed up their future prospects. Was it worth the risk to try to escape? Dr. Zbigniew Godlewski's journey to Starobielsk echoed that of many of the captive officers. After losing contact with his division when it came under German attack near Warsaw, the young doctor had wandered ever further eastward, tending to the wounded as best he could, before eventually falling into the hands of the Red Army as he tried to escape home from Białystok. Separated from his friend and fellow medic, Barch, Godlewski spent his first night in the camp alone, falling fast asleep in a stone trough resembling a coffin, his army rucksack serving as a pillow. The following morning, Barch reappeared carrying a bowl of lukewarm porridge which he had somehow, miraculously, managed to obtain from a kitchen somewhere within the crowded camp. Godlewski was delighted to be reunited with his friend, but noticed Barch seemed agitated, scarcely able to conceal his impatience while Godlewski ate his breakfast. As soon as the porridge was gone, Barch spoke. He had a plan, he declared. The enlisted men and NCOs from German-occupied regions of Poland were about to leave. What did Godlewski think about taking the very same train on which they had just arrived and getting out of there? My face must have shown such fear, he stepped away and went over to a corporal near him who was urging him to leave. After a long while he came back, saying lots of people were going and everyone was telling him to get out of this place as quickly as possible. Godlewski refused. He thought the risk too great. We embraced warmly, and I realized I was saying goodbye to a true friend. Barch left the camp undetected, along with an unspecified number of other officers. There are no records to tell us how many of these men were caught or how many made it back to Poland alive. It was some years before Godlewski discovered Bartsch's fate. He reached Warsaw without incident, but was immediately arrested by the Gestapo. As a doctor, he was allowed to work in the prison hospital, thus surviving the war. After the first few days, the prisoners were allocated more permanent places in one of the semi-ruined buildings which were gradually growing emptier as the enlisted men moved out. Orders arrived from somewhere, nobody yet knew from whom, instructing officers to be billeted with others of the same rank. In each of the three camps, the procedure was identical. Buildings were designated as blocks, numbered, and segregated by seniority. Numbers tell a story. Imprisoned in the camps of Starobielsk and Kozielsk were some of Poland's most skilled military leaders. Starobielsk held the highest number of senior and staff officers, 8 generals, Bilewicz, Haller, Kowalewski, Orlik-Łukowski, Plisowski, Sikorski, Skierski, Skuratowicz. 181 lieutenant colonels and colonels, 316 majors, 843 captains, 2,527 lieutenants and second lieutenants, 9 other officers, plus a handful of others. When Starobielsk was full, Kozielsk took the overflow. 4 generals, Minkiewicz, Bohatarewicz, Smorawiński, Volkowitski. 1 admiral, Czernicki. 98 lieutenant colonels and colonels, 232 majors, 647 captains, 17 naval captains, 8 other officers, 3,480 lieutenants, second lieutenants and cadet officers, 61 state officials, plus a handful of others. With over 6,000 prisoners, Ostashkov was the largest of the three camps. Police and gendarmes made up the majority, alongside 200 to 300 army officers, 200 or so prison workers, and a handful of Polish military settlers, refugees and civilians. Over half the officers in Kozielsk and Starobielsk were not professional military men, but reservists mobilised shortly before the outbreak of war. In civilian life, they were doctors, dentists, pharmacists, veterinary surgeons, lawyers, judges, court officials. In Kozielsk, there were so many judges they had their own block. Engineers, school teachers, university professors, journalists, writers, poets, industrialists, politicians, businessmen. The very youngest were officer cadets in their early 20s. A couple of teenage boys had even been captured by mistake. The majority of officers came from the army, a small number from the Air Force and Navy. Kozielsk held a single female prisoner, Janina Lewandowska, a pilot who'd been shot down in a reconnaissance plane. She was held separately. A handful of civilians also found themselves among the military men, captured by mistake or for reasons unknown. In November 1939, the former major-domo to the Polish president appeared in Starobielsk, dressed in a ragged fur coat minus his teeth, a stocking pulled over his head against the cold. Major-domo Michalski's illustrious connections had apparently convinced the NKVD that he was in possession of important intelligence, hence the missing teeth, knocked out during a series of brutal interrogations. He was housed alongside the majors, whether because the NKVD misunderstood his official title or not is unclear, but it tickled the prisoners to call him Major Michalski. Between 20 and 25 clergy of various faiths, mainly military chaplains, were spread across the three camps. As desperate diplomatic efforts to avert war continued throughout August 1939, the British and French had urged the Poles to hold off announcing general mobilisation to the very last minute for fear of provoking Hitler. As a consequence, when the announcement finally came, many officers set off for war in a hurry. Some, anticipating a short battle, wore light summer uniforms. Others thought ahead to a long campaign and packed winter coats and heavy boots. Warsaw was already under attack when Bronisław Młynarski was called up. But as he hurried to join his unit, he had the foresight to pay a last-minute visit to his tailor, acquiring a new cap and a top-quality greatcoat originally destined for a colonel killed on the first day of the war. With the onset of winter, these last-minute choices were to prove vitally important, marking the difference between sickness and health. No clothing was ever issued to the prisoners. In April 1940, the victims went to their deaths dressed in the same garments in which they'd been captured. The senior Polish officer in Kozielsk was retired 59-year-old General Henryk Minkiewicz. When the Red Army came for him, he was working on his allotment, dressed in a shabby brown suit with knickerbocker trousers and a cyclist cap. He was so ashamed of this undignified garb that he rarely ventured outside in Kozielsk, preferring to issue orders and words of encouragement from the privacy of his quarters. The NKVD made a point of refusing to acknowledge the rank or status of any prisoner, however important he thought he might be. It was a policy deliberately designed to provoke and humiliate their captives and flew in the face of military custom, as well as the Geneva Convention. Nevertheless, in all three camps, senior officers were afforded superior accommodation, a reflection either of Beria's wish to be seen to respect at least some of the conventions of war, or of the fact that high-ranking officers were a more valuable asset to the NKVD. The majority of prisoners in Kozielsk slept on primitive bunks in the freezing church building, the Indian tomb. By contrast, the four generals and Admiral Chernitsky enjoyed separate quarters furnished with proper beds and tables on which hot meals were served from a kitchen. The same was true of the colonels and lieutenant colonels, who lived in a nearby block nicknamed Bristol, in reference to the luxurious Warsaw Hotel, still in operation today, still enviably plush. All prisoners received a ration of 800 grams of black bread daily, accompanied most often by a cabbage soup known as shchi, fowl, sour, and kasha, porridge, for lunch and supper. Along with this came a small daily allowance of tea, chayok, sugar, and mahorka, a kind of ersatz tobacco made from ground vegetables, which was handed out to all prisoners regardless of whether they smoked, leading to a lively trade in which the non-smokers were at a distinct advantage. Senior officers received more generous rations. The eight generals in Starobielsk ranged in age from their 40s to their 70s. Over half were living in retirement at the outbreak of war. On arrival in Starobielsk, they were separated from the other officers and taken to a house in town. Seven of them lived on Volodarskaya Street. The eighth, the leader of the defence of Lviv, General Franciszek Sikorski, lived with his staff at 19 Lenin Street. Around 100 colonels and lieutenant colonels occupied a house at 32 Kirov Street. We know nothing of the generals' lives, since none survived. They lived in isolation, and for much of their captivity, the officers in the main camp were unaware of their presence nearby. Lieutenant Colonel, later General, Zygmunt Berling, describes the colonel's house on Kirov Street as a large single-story dwelling, probably once a school, standing directly on the street, its windows barred. The colonels lived in relative comfort. They slept on bunks, 10 or 12 to a room, with a wood-burning stove. They prepared their own food in an indoor kitchen. A guard lived on site in a smaller room. It is reasonable to assume the generals enjoyed similar or slightly better conditions. The majority of the officers in Kozielsk came from the German-occupied zone of Poland. They lived in the main monastery complex, along with prisoners from Lithuania, either in the church building or one of the blocks scattered around the camp, known by various ironic nicknames, Chinese Grove, Monkey Grove, or Louse Hotel on Destitution Square. The remaining quarter of the camp's population, around 1,000 men, was made up of officers whose homes were in the Soviet zone of occupation. They were held separately in the Skit, formerly a refuge for hermit monks, where Gogol, Dostoevsky and Tolstoy sought inspiration, and Rasputin was once rumoured to have stayed. Surrounded by a pleasant forest of pine, spruce, beech and oak, the Skit was nearly half a mile from the main camp. Although it was sometimes possible to communicate with the help of Russian workers, the officers here were relatively isolated. For 22-year-old cavalry cadet officer Zdzisław Peszkowski, visiting the monastery, Greater Kozielsk, was a highlight of otherwise dull days, offering a rare opportunity to obtain news and information. In Ostashkov, prisoners lived in 22 blocks scattered around the former monastery complex. The small number of higher-ranking officers enjoyed superior accommodation in two rooms furnished with beds, blankets, sheets, chairs, cupboards and stools. When visitors came to inspect the camp, these were the only two rooms on show. Everyone else slept on damp, cold bunks infested with bedbugs. Bronisław Młynarski was delighted to find himself billeted with his friends, all reserve second lieutenants or lieutenants like him, in block number 8 in Starobielsk, a small house standing on half-meter posts. Officers slept tightly packed on bunks so short their legs hung over the edges. In the first days before the privates left, those not lucky enough to grab a bunk had to sleep on the floor, while prisoners who had secured a place on the top tier, where there was just enough room for a man to assume a half-seated position, had to balance this advantage with the fact that the smell of unwashed bodies, mud and dirt rose upwards. A single light bulb remained on throughout the night. Lice lurked everywhere. Many years later, Dr. Godlewski still recalled his sense of horror at discovering the creatures crawling all over his body. Arriving in Starobielsk in late October, Józef Czapski initially found himself isolated from the comrades in his unit with whom he had spent the past few weeks. Although at 43 he was only 3 years older than Bronisław Młynarski, as a captain he was assigned with a group of older men to a block known unflatteringly as the morgue, not only because of its high incidence of sickness, but because its residents, many of whom, ironically, were doctors, were so bitterly defeatist. Czapski could not bear their company. An equivalent block in Kozielsk, inhabited by older majors, was dubbed the Old People's Home. A devotee of Paul Cézanne and Marcel Proust, Czapski had spent his early career in Paris before returning to Poland in the 1930s to consolidate his reputation as a talented painter and critic. He was a sensitive and deeply private man, accustomed to working in solitude, surrounded by books, with a small group of close friends with whom he could discuss his twin passions of art and literature. Now he found himself pitched into a crowd of confused and angry men, crawling with lice, covered in mud, unable to wash, and without sufficient food. Worse than the physical discomfort of those early days was the mental anguish, as, isolated and trapped in his grief, each man dwelled on the defeat of the Polish army, the humiliation of their capture, and, most painfully, the absence of news from their families. Strung up outside the blocks in every corner of the camp were loudspeakers which churned out propaganda from dawn until late at night. News from the front boasting of the bombardment of Polish towns, endless tales of wealthy capitalists sucking blood from the oppressed Polish workers, all of this intermingled with bursts of music and the latest production figures from local factories and collective farms. Under these circumstances, it is scarcely surprising that some officers initially experienced what Czapski defined as a kind of moral collapse. Oh, the mornings when we were awakened abruptly by the sound of quarrels which often broke out over nothing. There were some sickening scenes sometimes in those first weeks. Two high-ranking officers fought with each other, pulling one another by the beard because they each wanted to be the first to reach a well surrounded by black ice. Disputes blew up easily, matters of honour, arguments over rank and position. Professional officers in particular found the situation hard to bear. The deliberate lack of respect afforded by the NKVD, the refusal of even the most junior guard to salute officers or address them by their rank, was bitterly humiliating. For men whose lives were wholly bound up in the army, it was another bewildering insult to add to the despair they felt at their military defeat. It can be hard to grasp the atmosphere in which these thousands of individuals existed alongside one another. The image of Polish officers incarcerated in a prison camp suggests a mass of like-minded men united in purpose and background. Words like elite or the cream of society convey a similarly deceptive sense of uniformity. But these were human beings, not saints. Quite apart from the differences that defined career soldiers from their reservist comrades, the prisoners represented every conceivable political and social viewpoint and a complete cross-section of the professions. They were artists, scientists, judges, journalists, doctors, poets, engineers, teachers of literature, physics, maths and art, experts in mining and ballistics, Latin philology and military history, Catholics, Lutherans, atheists, Jews, snobs and socialists, aristocrats and entrepreneurs, pompous know-it-alls and men of unfailing courage. If we imagine what it might be like to cram several thousand such men into a crumbling, freezing former monastery consisting of ruined buildings and muddy grounds, to leave them unwashed and underfed, Isolated from all news of their former lives and families, deprived of recognition of their status and rank, it might be possible to understand the chaos and despair of those early days in captivity. It might also allow us for a moment to pause to imagine what the loss of such a group of men might represent to a country and its families. As camp life settled into something approaching a routine and the departure of the enlisted men created more space, these painful first impressions were gradually replaced by more positive observations. Bronisław Młynarski noted that although their physical suffering was at its worst during these first few weeks, the great majority of prisoners bore their burden with dignity, their optimism buoyed by a set of firm beliefs later to succumb to the dry rot of uncertainty. That Hitler would be overcome, that their conditions would improve, that the Allies would come to Poland's aid, that there was justice in history, that Providence would take care of us. Chapsky, too, observed that those men whom misfortune appeared to have divested of all dignity and whose only concern was to procure a little more food or a warm corner were a small but noisy group, soon put in their place by men of a firmer character. Gradually, the prisoners began to discern among the crowds old friends, relatives, colleagues not seen since before the war. New friendships were formed, old ones renewed, a semblance of order established. As they took stock of their surroundings, the outlines of their new existence gradually took shape. The question uppermost in every man's mind concerned the nature of the camps in which they were being held. Most prisoner of war camps were run by the army. There were clear rules and expectations for officers and other ranks. What did it mean to be in the hands of the NKVD? Who was in charge? And what did they want from their Polish captives? Chapter 2. Names. From our very first day at Starobielsk, it had become clear to us that one figure, who on casual observation looked no different from our other guardians, exercised supreme authority. In his early 40s, with strong Semitic features, clean-shaven, ruddy and red-haired, he would stroll about the camp without visible aim, in an insignialess brown jacket. Only his cap, with a red band, denoted his membership of the NKVD. Intelligent, clever and self-controlled, he used a friendly tone that was sometimes jesting and sometimes betrayed a note of superiority. The measure of this little man's authority was the fact that at the sight of him, politruks and commandeers of one rank or another stood to attention, looking into his narrowed eyes with humility and obedience. For this unimpressive-looking fellow, in brown leather jacket and red cap, was Kirshin, the camp's political commissar. Ever since the moment when the young Red Army recruits who robbed them of their valuables were replaced by politruks wearing the red-banded caps of the NKVD, the prisoners had slowly been realising that the ruined monasteries to which they had been taken were not regular prisoner of war camps. In the succinct words of Kozelsk prisoner Stanisław Svianiewicz, very soon after arriving in Kozelsk, it became obvious that it was mainly an interrogation camp. When the UPV, Administration for Prisoner of War Affairs, was set up by Beria on the 19th of September, all camps where Polish POWs were to be taken were assigned a commander in charge of organisational matters and a commissar who controlled the political side of things. In addition, within each camp, a special section, or OO, Osoboe Oddelenia, was responsible for intelligence work. Moscow's orders to the special sections were precise and exacting. On arrival, they were to register and photograph each prisoner before requiring them to fill in a detailed personal questionnaire. Record files were to be opened on each individual, kept in alphabetical order, and allotted a number. Any prisoners of war found to be conducting anti-Soviet work, as well as those belonging to specific political groups, were to be investigated and a file established on them. The entire officer contingent was to be included in the category of those under investigation. On the first of each month, the special section in each camp was to submit an operational report to the regional NKVD special department with a copy sent to Moscow. Lavrenty Beria's lengthy directive on operational Cheka intelligence work, dated 8th of October 1939 and addressed to the special sections of NKVD camps across the USSR, sets out in minute detail what the NKVD was looking for. According to this directive, the first task of the OOs was to create an agency informational network to uncover CR, counter-revolutionary, groupings among the POWs and to shed light on their moods. In other words, he wanted them to use spies and informers to identify and monitor any prisoners whose political viewpoint could be seen as inimical to the Soviet system. They were to use the registration process as an opportunity to familiarize themselves with the prisoners and select suitable candidates as agents. With this in place, they could focus on the job of uncovering and penetrating a list of organizations so long it begged the question whether there were any pre-war Polish organizations the NKVD did not consider suspicious. A. Individuals who served in the intelligence, police and security organs of former Poland, branch agencies, intelligence posts, state security departments in the voivodeships, provinces, police stations, intelligence sections attached to military units, intelligence sections attached to Dowództwo Okręgowo Korpus Nowy, district corps commands, prison employees, and those serving in KOP, Polish Frontier Protection Corps. B. Secret agencies of the organs listed above, informants, intelligence agents. C. Participants in fascist military nationalistic organizations of former Poland. There follows a list of 11 organizations, including the Polish Military Organization, Polish Socialist Party, various professional unions, Zionists, and others. D. Employees of law courts and the prosecutor's office. E. Secret agencies of other foreign intelligence services. F. Participants in foreign white emigre terrorist organizations. There follows a list of 12 organizations. G. Provocateurs from the former Tsarist secret police and persons who served in the police and prison institutions of pre-revolutionary Russia. H. Provocateurs from secret police in the fraternal communist parties of Poland, Western Ukraine, and Belarus. I. Kulak and anti-Soviet elements who fled to the former Poland from the USSR. The complexity of the requirement set out by Beria presupposed a level of efficiency not necessarily matched by the competence of available staff in camps located far from Moscow with large numbers of prisoners to process. The struggle to recruit suitably qualified staff was a constant source of complaint among camp leaders. Inspecting Ostashkov, Commissar Makarov commented scathingly on the workers engaged in creating POW records. The majority of those who have been assigned to the job have a very low level of education. They are half illiterate, as a consequence of which the records are in a mess and do not reflect the real state of affairs. Not only this, the wrong documents had been sent to German territory, while other papers were left lying around or placed in unlocked cupboards with no regard for their security. Meanwhile, a power struggle between the commander of the camp, Pavel Borisavets, and the head of the special section, Grigory Korytov, had resulted in several thousand police and gendarme registration forms and photographs lying untouched for an entire month because the two men were too busy arguing about who was responsible for filing them. Worse, the offices allotted by Borisavets to the special section were situated in full view of the camp yard. All day long, policemen, gendarmes, snoopers, etc. are hanging about in the yard, and they themselves are great specialists in conspiracies and take note of everyone who goes near the special section. Policing a camp full of policemen was evidently not a straightforward task. Commissar Makarov was not alone in noting the gulf between ambition and reality. At the age of 40, Chief Inspector Jan Bober had a long career in the Polish police behind him, much of it spent flushing out Ukrainian nationalists and communist spies in Poland's eastern regions. A fervent patriot with strong opinions he was not shy of sharing, Bober had frequently come into conflict with his superiors. One described him as an exceptionally disloyal swine and a plotter, as a consequence of which he had more than once been demoted. Prisoners were photographed several times and, in Ostashkov camp at least, fingerprinted. While the photographs were taken according to international norms, in two poses, straight on and in profile, the prisoner holding a board bearing his personal file number against his chest, Bober thought the quality of the fingerprinting left much to be desired. "The way they were carried out, it was pitiful. The prints were illegible. Moscow's central administration must have had very little joy from those prints. At Sarabyask, dozens of clerks were bussed in from the local town to register the prisoners. The process was initially hampered by a shortage of paper and ink, then rendered chaotic by the fact that most of the clerks knew only the Cyrillic alphabet and could not correctly transliterate the Polish surnames, much to the amusement of the captive officers. The camp commander, Alexander Bereshkov, eventually gave up and ordered the senior Polish liaison officer, Major Sobiesław Zaleski, to organise the job instead. When camp numbers eventually stabilised in November, Major Zaleski decided it would be a good idea to create their own list. He duly entrusted Bronisław Winarski with the task, and Winarski spent much of the autumn diligently compiling a 200-page document containing an alphabetical list of just under 4,000 names, including notes on those who died or were taken to hospital or were removed from the camp never to return. The list survived until Winarski's last day in the camp, when it was found by the Soviet guards during a search. When Józef Czapski was leading the search for the missing officers in 1941, he was forced to compile the records again from scratch. Enjoyable as it was for the prisoners to observe the bureaucratic stumblings of their captors, their mood swiftly changed when they saw the questionnaires. The forms presented a series of searching questions. What were your military duties? Give the locality and date of your capture by the Red Army. State your political affiliations, your parents' names, your job in civilian life. In considering how to respond to these questions, the men were chiefly anxious about the possible consequences for their families if they revealed information about them. Nevertheless, most answered truthfully. Prisoners whose homes were in the Soviet zone rightly assumed that whatever they wrote was already known to the NKVD. Those from central and western Poland reckoned the NKVD were probably exchanging information with the Gestapo. Besides, guards had confiscated...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.